Real quick about the raising the hands. I tell you, you know, I was saved. Well, I was raised Catholic, but I was saved Baptist, and I know what it's like to not raise hands. You know, you're kind of almost taught in the Baptist church that that's illegal, and amen, right? You don't do that, you know. But I never forget one day. You know, let me say this. How many know when we go to football games, what do we usually do? Woo! Right? We go crazy. You don't go,
I'm sorry, this is the way I worship football.
Right? You get excited. Everyone does the wave. You very rarely see someone stand like this. Everyone does the wave, right? Well, think about it. If you go crazy for a football game that really doesn't care a whole lot about you, amen, and a basketball team, how much more should you be willing to do the wave for Jesus? Amen? And understand the wave is not really just the wave. Woo! You might see me do that, right? Everyone says the big tree swing in the front. But what it really is what? It's getting your spiritual antennas. Where is the Holy Spirit? No, that's not it. No, what it is it's surrendering to God. It's saying, Lord, I surrender myself to you. It's kind of like kneeling. Why do we kneel? We kneel to show humility to God. Why do we bow? We show humility. Lifting our hands is saying, Lord, I surrender my life to you. How many could use surrendering their life more to God? Amen? There you go. Okay, three of you. That's good. But all of us could. Amen? Surrender, and that's what it is. I love what one man of God described worship. He said it's love responding to love. How many know God has loved you immensely? He's proven it by the cross. He's proven it by being so patient with us. And the way we show love to him is by what? Surrendering to his will. And we're going to see that today, so it fits perfectly. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Philippians chapter 2, verse 19. Philippians chapter 2, verse 19. And let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this day. And as your word says in the Old Testament, enter your gates with thanksgiving, your courts with praise. A lot of the Jewish men would lift their hands, lifting up holy hands. And Lord, your New Testament says, I want men to lift up their holy hands without wrath or doubting. And so, God, let us not be ashamed to lift our hands to you as surrender, saying, I surrender my life, I surrender my family, I surrender everything I have to you. Lord, let us be surrendered people, Lord. I pray that we'll believe like Washington, like our first president said, you cannot govern well unless you yourself are governed by God. Let us be submitted to you. Let us be yielded to you, Father. I ask that we would not see submission as a form of weakness, but we'd see it like the centurion soldier who said to you, I'm a man under authority, and my commanding officer tells me to go or to come, and I go or come. But then I have men under me, and I tell them to go, and I tell them to come, and they come. Because why? I'm a man under authority. Let us be people that are under your authority, amen? We're yielded to you, we're surrendered to you, and we say, not my will, but your will be done. That's why we're studying your word today, Lord, to learn what is your will, to hear your spirit speak to us, to shine light on some areas of our life that might not be right with you, areas that we might be doing that isn't your will, or areas that we're not doing something that we should be, like lifting holy hands. So, Father, help us. I pray that people wouldn't just be here to learn more about your word, but they would be here to learn your word to be obedient disciples of you. Amen. That they would say, I want, when I hear something that I'm not doing, I'll do it. And when I hear something that I shouldn't be doing that I'm doing, I'll surrender it. I'll confess it. So bless us as your people that we'll be obedient, that we'll be holy people set apart for you. I ask, O God, that you would anoint my tongue, anoint my mind to speak only what you would have me speak. And Lord, I ask for everyone that's here or out in the audience or out in the lobby or on the internet, I pray that you would speak to them, that they would hear you speak, not me. We give you this time and we pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. Henry Greed said, amen. Amen. Verse 19 of Philippians chapter 2. But I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly. Jesus, as we've been seeing in our study of Philippians, the book of Philippians, he is the ultimate example of a submitted mind, of someone who's submitted to God. Remember, although we learned the kenosis, does anyone remember the kenosis? It's, no one? Anyone remember the kenosis? One person. Okay, the kenosis is what? That although Jesus was equal with God Almighty, he's God Almighty come in the flesh, that he emptied himself and he became a servant, that he emptied himself to say, Father God, I will do whatever you tell me. I will empty myself of my, not my deity, but of my God abilities. I'll empty myself of being able to govern with you. I'll just say, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. I will surrender to you, Father. And how many know that's a picture of the church, right? Just as God is the head of the church, so, right, in Christ, so we now submit to Christ. And then just as the husband is the head of the family, the wife then what? Submits to the husband as unto Christ, as for the Lord. And that's how it works. Hear this. Can you hear this? That you cannot have authority without being under authority. Amen? A lot of people want to have authority, but very few men or women want to be under authority. And first authority you need to be under is who? God. If you're not under God, right? I love what Reagan said. He said, if we forget that we are one nation under God, then we will be a nation that gone under. And how many know that's where we're headed if we do not have an awakening, if we don't have a move of God? And that's why I say surrender. How many know if you're not lifting your hands for you, lift it for our nation to say, God, even though many are renouncing you, not wanting you to be in the public square, we welcome you in our public square. We welcome you back in our country, because guess what? The minute God leaves this country, the minute God withdraws his hand is the minute America stops being the America that we love. Amen? And so that should put a holy fear of God. How many know that we need the mercy of God? We need to appeal to him. If we do that, I don't know why we do the wave. Why do we do the wave? Does anyone know why we do the wave? Just to be weird. But how many know, lifting your hands to say, God, we need you. That's a good thing, and I encourage you to do so. And as a Baptist, well, I'll say this again. You know, I used to always say, oh, it's no big deal. What's the big deal? Raise your hands. Well, here's the point. If it's not a big deal, then why is it so hard for you to do it? Right? Because it's kind of, because it's like surrender. It's like, I might look weird. Well, guess what? The Bible calls us, what, strange people. We're not of this world, right? We're not just look like that. I mean, I don't say you run through the aisles like Kevin said and jump on that. We don't have chandeliers, but the light things. Don't do that. But how many know we should be able to be radical and say, God, I love you so much, I surrender all that I have for you. Well, Jesus is that example of submitted mind, and so was Paul. Also had this submitted mind to the Father's will. And here Paul writes of another one who had a submitted mind, and that is his young protege, Timothy. Timothy. Now you might be asking yourself, why is it so important, besides worship, to have a submitted mind to God the Father and his will for my life? Well, hear this. How many of you, and answer this please with an amen or a hand, how many of you want peace in your families? How many of you want that? Okay, all of you. How many of you want oneness in your marriages, love in your marriages? Amen, right? You don't want to, you don't, you know, yeah, there you go. Thank you. Okay, now, okay. Can't get you to raise your hands, but you got that. Okay, that's good. I like that. Yeah. All right, you guys are trouble. But anyways, now I don't even know where I am. You know, come back, mind. But anyways, marriages. How many of you want the devil and his demons to have no place in your life or your family's life? Amen. All of us. I don't know if you're not sure. I can't believe this. I don't know if people are smoking a lot of drugs out there, but you know, 40% of Christians do not believe in a literal devil. Wow. That's like, well, I was going to say something. It's like somebody in our administration that doesn't believe in Al-Qaeda. How many know if you don't believe in an enemy that's punching you in the face, how many know you're going to lose? Okay? Right? That's just weird. What is going on? I mean, if you don't believe in a real enemy, you're going to be rocked. And if you don't believe the devil wants to steal, kill, and destroy your life, you're already defeated. Amen? You need to know, you know, that there's an enemy out there who hates you and especially hates all humanity, but especially hates Christians. And if you don't know your authority in Christ, if you don't know that this battle is real, I love what C.S. Lewis said, and think about how much this fits for us. He said, most Americans or most Christians think of this earth as a playground. Isn't that it? Pleasure, playground. But he says, this earth is not a playground. It's a battleground. And if you don't know that, you're going to get rocked living for pleasure because the enemy is going to run you over, or he's going to get you so distracted with pleasure that you're going to end your life going, oh no, what did I do? I forgot God. I'm going to say this right now. I'm going to say it again later, but I will tell you this. Andy, my friend, says this, that live your life without regret. I want to tell you this. It's nothing sadder than when I see Christians die. And I see some Christians, you ever seen it? Where their eyes are twinkling, even though they're in pain, because they're excited to meet Jesus. But then I see other Christians die, and you see that eye of, oh no, I'm going to see God. How many know you don't want to die that way? Amen? You don't want, I'll take it by your quietness. You're going, amen. Thanks for bringing that up, death. Right? You're going to die. 100% of you are going to die. It's a fact. Okay? And you can either die going, wow, I get to see Jesus, or, oh no, I'm going to see Jesus. But my heart is that every one of you will say, I fought the good fight, I finished the race, and now lays up for me a crown of righteousness. I'm excited to see God because I've yielded my life to his will. Amen? Amen. James 4:7 says this. It says, therefore, submit to God and resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Hear this, guys. Everyone wants deliverance. Everyone wants freedom from the demonic attacks in your life. Everyone wants that. But hear this. I just did deliverance this week, and hear this. I couldn't do deliverance this week on this person because this person did not want to submit their will to God's. And I said to them, I can't pray for you. I've already prayed for them once, but then it kind of came back. But I said, I can't pray for you because you're not submitted to God. Because hear this, if you pray for someone, like you pray for a non-Christian to be delivered, then what happens? Remember the scripture? Seven more demons will come back more powerful than before, and this house will be worse than it was in the first state. And how many know it's the same for Christians? If you're saying, I surrender God in most areas, but not every area, how many know the devil holds onto that and says, hey, I got him. I got her. And you have to say, even though it might be hard, how many know, you can still say, I submit to God even when it's hard. Amen? God understands our weakness. He understands we are but dust. But if you say, no, Lord, how many know that God has a problem with that? But if you say, oh, Lord, it's hard, help me, God says, I can work with that. Amen? You guys tracking with me? All right? So everyone wants deliverance, but nobody, well, not nobody, let me say that. Very few people really want to submit their whole life to God. Nobody in their right mind wants the presence of the demonic in their family. But as we see here, the Word of God says that you can't have a true deliverance or true protection from the demonic if you're not fully submitted to God. Should that scare some of you, shouldn't it? Because there's areas that we willfully say, no, Lord, you can't touch that, Lord. Has anyone heard of the book called, a little booklet called Christ's Heart, My Home? Has anyone heard of it, a couple of you? It's really great how he talks about our life being like a house and our playroom and our billiard room and the eating room and all these different rooms. But he talks about this back closet that we have, and we have stinky stuff in there. And the Lord's like kind of going, there's some, let's look at this closet. No, no, Lord, no, that's mine. And a lot of us have some closets, right? We talk about skeletons in our closets. How many know Jesus wants you to be skeleton free? Have you heard about Josh Duggar? How many know that man? How many know if you're not sure, the Bible says your sins will find you out. He who conceals his sin will not prosper. How many know that man has pretty much shipwrecked his ministry, I would believe, not maybe his salvation, but ministry, because guess what? You cannot walk in blatant sin today without being exposed. And I tell you, I say that to you, hopefully that you'll have the fear of God in you that says, I don't want to do that. I don't want to have an area of my life that the devil's got a hold on my life. I don't want to walk in blatant sin. When I mess up, I admit it and quit it. I cry and say, that's it, right? Okay. But I mean, we quit it. We say enough. It's like Bob Dylan says. Do you remember Bob Dylan when he did his little Christian debut? A great album was Slow Train Coming. And I always scare you guys by singing it. Do you want to hear my Bob Dylan song? Yeah, okay, here it is. But he said this. He goes, I'll read it first. You got to serve somebody. It may be the devil or it may be the Lord, but you got to serve somebody. And he said this. You got to serve somebody. It may be the devil. Maybe the Lord, but you gotta serve somebody. It's like, I don't know, I don't want to say it. It sounds like he's doing something he shouldn't. But anyway, you gotta serve somebody. And hear this. We as Christians think we have three kingdoms, don't we? We think we have the kingdom of the Lord. We think we have the kingdom of the devil. But we think there's a third kingdom. There's a kingdom of self. My will be done. But I want to tell you this, guys. There is only two kingdoms. Is that two? Two kingdoms. Right? The kingdom of darkness and the kingdom of light. Jesus' kingdom and Satan's kingdom. And hear this. Whenever you and I walk in the kingdom of self, guess whose kingdom you're walking in, whether you think it or not. You're walking in the kingdom of darkness. Remember what Isaiah says? Isaiah 14:14, Satan said, I will make myself like the Most High God. When you sing like Elvis or you sing like Frank Sinatra, I did it my way. You might as well say, I'm a Satanist, because that's what it is. You might not have the horns and be like, but you are living for the kingdom of self. And that's what, hear this, guys, that's what kicked Satan out of heaven like lightning, Jesus said. Did you hear that? You want Jesus in your home? You want Jesus in your life? You want to be filled with His Spirit? Then here's how you welcome the Lord, by having a submissive heart and mind to Him to say, Lord, what is your will? I'll do it. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Middle of verse 19. That I also may be encouraged when I know your state. Know the welfare of the church, basically. Paul is saying here, I'm sending Timothy to you that I might find out how you're doing. Hear this, guys. A true pastor or a true Christian cares about the state or the welfare of the church. I want to tell you this. The church has done a lot of bad things. The church has a lot of hypocrisy in it, right? I don't want you to say amen, but we all know it, right? But hear this. I always love when people say, well, the church is full of hypocrites. And I always say, yeah, and there's room for one more. But hear this. I say that jokingly, but hear this. We should try to want to sin less today than we did yesterday. We should not justify hypocrisy. We shouldn't want to be just a church that's full of sin. But hear this, guys. Jesus loves His church. I have walked away from the ministry. I've been in ministry coming on December 5th, 34 years, longer than a lot of you have been born. And I've walked away from ministry. I said, I hate your church. I hate the politics. I hate the weirdness. And Jesus has spoken to my heart so clearly to say, God, or say, Craig, if you love me, then you need to love my church, because I love my church and I died for my church. And if you don't love my church, then we got a problem. Do you hear that? And guess what the church is? The church is us. This is just a house. This is just the tent for us to meet in. It isn't the building, okay? And some of you go, that's right. That's why I don't tithe, right? But how many? We need money to keep the building. How many like AC? Anyone like AC? There you go. That's why we need you to give, okay? But hear this. The church is us, right? The church is us. And hear this. You say, oh, the church is full of hypocrites. Guess what? Usually the people that say the church is full of hypocrites are usually the biggest hypocrite themselves. Because I don't say the church is full of hypocrites anymore, because I know I'm a hypocrite at times. How many know if you ask God, pray this prayer today if you're not sure you're a hypocrite. Lord, is there any area of my life where I'm a hypocrite? How many know God could show you in about 2 seconds? Or just ask your wife. Proverbs 27:23 says, be diligent to know the state of your flocks. You need to know the state of your flocks. You need to know the state of your church. You need to know the state of your business. You need to know the state, most of all, of your home. Amen? A lot of dads have no clue about their kids, what's going on with their kids. You need to know, because guess what, parents? You're going to give an account for how you raise God's kids. How many know? They're God's kids entrusted to you. Amen? These are God's kids given to you to be good stewards, which means a servant manager. These aren't your kids, my kids. No, they're God's kids given to you to raise in the fear of the Lord, to raise according to the Word of God. How many know that? And so you need to know that. Now you might be saying, well, Craig, that's good. That's good for you to love the church. That's good for you. But I don't really care about the church. And I don't really care. I don't have a heart for the state of the church. Well, if you're a parent, how many of you are parents out there? Raise your hands. Are you parents? Most of you have been a parent or a parent right now. Well, you're always a parent, I guess. Parent. Guess what? You're a pastor. You're a pastor of your children, right? You're a pastor. You're a deaconess, because you're going to give an account to the Lord on how you raised, as I said, His kids. And He's entrusted your care. Hear this. Deuteronomy 6:6 says this. And let me preface it. Does anyone know this? I found this out a couple years ago. Does anyone know the golden commandment? The golden commandment. Does anyone know? Is that one person else? Good. Well, the Jewish people talk about the golden commandment, or let me give it to you this way, you'll hopefully know it, the greatest commandment. What's the greatest commandment? Love the Lord thy God, Deuteronomy 6:4. And he's saying to them, hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one God. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. I always put add the mind. But love him with all your heart. And here's what he says to the children right after he says that, or to the parents. He says, and these words which I have commanded you today shall be in your heart. Verse 7, you shall teach them diligently to your children. Hear that, teach them. Don't just hope, I hope my kids love God, or I love what parents say. Well,
you know, I just don't want to force it on my kids.
How many know your public school is forcing some things on your kids, right? Caitlyn Jenner's a great thing, amen? What, you don't think that's cool? What's wrong with you? You bigot, right? Isn't that the world? They don't have a problem forcing things on us, do they? No. But we, oh, how dare us try to encourage our kids to love God. You need to encourage your kids to love God. You need to. That's what the command is here. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and you shall talk to them when you sit in your house. So when you're sitting around, instead of watching TV all the time, maybe sit around and have a Bible study. Talk about the sermon today. Talk about how funny Craig is. Ooh, something. And talk to them in your house. And when you walk, by the way, when you're walking down the road, we don't walk too much anymore. Now it'd be as you're driving your car. How's that? You're driving your car. Talk to them about the Lord. When you lie down right before bed, talk to them. When you rise up, talk to them. Sounds kind of like God wants you to talk a lot about him day and night to your kids. And let me know, those of you who have older kids, you know how fast they're out of the house, like this, right? Gone. And you need to, you have about 18 years. And nowadays, well, I guess that's not true. Nowadays, they say the average kid lives in the house till 28. So you got 28 years, okay? Hopefully our kids aren't that way, right? Hopefully our kids, right? Christian kids shouldn't be living in the house for 28 years, right? You're responsible to teach and train your children the ways of the Lord. Proverbs, I'm going to read two scriptures to you real quick. Proverbs 22:6 says this, train a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not turn from it. Hear this, that word train there, it's kind of neat. It means like training a horse. How many know you can have a beautiful stallion? Some of you guys go, yeah, my son's a stallion. Right? He's just bucking all the time. Right? And he's just going crazy. Come on, that's funny. No? No. But anyways, you got stallions or stallionesses, right? You know, you got girls with hair, right? Like that. But hear this, you have to break them, right? What good is a beautiful stallion if you can't ride the stallion? If you get on the stallion, you're going through the air 20 feet in the air. That's not a good stallion. It has the same meaning of the word meekness, right? We all know meekness. It means what? Strength under control. Another meaning of it is it means like training a horse. It means having a powerful horse that is yielded to its master or its rider. How many know that's what God wants from you and I? He wants you to be strong in him, but he wants you to be yielded to him, because guess what? A crazy horse is just that, a crazy horse. And he doesn't want to just, you ever been on a horse where they just start running? You're like, I can't stop it. It's scary. I had a horse do that once, and we almost ran into a barbed wire fence, and I had to yank that horse so hard that, I mean, it backed up for like a mile because I pulled it so hard in the rain. But it was terrifying to have an animal that big just going crazy. And how many know God can stop us? I'm not saying God's like, woo, but you know, he wants us to be yielded. You get the picture? And we need to train our children. And it means this, you're going to love this. Some of you go, politically correct people, oh, that's so mean. It means like putting a bit in their mouth. What's a bit do? Puts pressure on the tongue, some pain. It puts some pain. And here's the verse to say that too. Proverbs 22:15, just a couple verses up. It says, a youngster's heart is full of foolishness or folly, but physical discipline will drive it far away. I have to be careful with this because we live in a politically correct society. But how many know, if you have more than one kid, maybe timeout works good if you have one kid. But if you have four kids or five or more, guess what? Sometimes a timeout does not work. Sometimes you need a little timeout on the bottom. Now hear me. Some of you go, he's saying beat my precious angel? No, I'm not saying beat them. I'm saying spank them. Discipline love, not in anger, right? I was beat. There's a difference between spanking and beating, right? Look at me. You can see. No. But beating, you know, in the head. No, I'm talking a little swat on the butt to say, this hurts me more than it's going to hurt you. And my kids go, no, Dad, it hurts me good. No, boom, you know, and let them know, hey, we don't do that in this house. And guess what? Because why? It teaches kids that there's consequences to sin. It teaches there is consequence. How many? I love what Dr. Dobson said. I don't like some of the things he says I don't agree with, but he said this. If you don't discipline your kid, if you're not willing to spank them or discipline them and show them some pain, then guess what? A police officer will be happy to do the job that you, well, they're trying to stop police officers from doing that now, but they used to be able to do that and say to your kid with a nightstick, you shouldn't do that anymore. How many would rather be training their kids than a police officer training your kids? Amen? Or a detention center or a prison? Amen? You get it? And so we need to do that. We need to have that. We need to say no to little Johnny and little, Sally. All right, sorry if you're Sally or Johnny there, but verse 20. For I have no one like-minded who sincerely cares for your state. Paul had a lot of men around him in Rome, but he only had one Timothy. Notice this. He had tons of people around him. This is what one commentator said, but only one person would go to Philippi. Isn't that amazing? How many know that? I love what people, when I get you guys to sign up to do stuff, they'll say, some people just put on the card, I'll do anything. Then you ask, will you usher? Anything but ushering. Okay, will you teach Sunday school? Anything but Sunday school. Okay, will you clean a bathroom? Anything but pretty much what anything means is just I'll teach a men's Bible study. How many know anything should mean anything? Okay, if you don't mean anything, don't write anything. But a lot of people write that because it sounds noble but how many know it frustrates us when we ask you to do something, you say no, 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 pretty much no, right? You need to mean what you say. But Paul had a lot of men around him, but only one Timothy. I've noticed that over the years, a lot of men and women love to teach the word of God, but very few men and women really care for God's church, which is his people. How many of you know today that I have a lot of good, there's a lot of good teachers out there, are there not? A lot of good teachers. You got teachers on the radio, on the internet, you got great teachers. But hear this, but you don't have many good shepherds. Or as Paul said, you have many teachers, but not many what? Fathers. A father will not just tell you good stuff and say whatever. A father will say, son, daughter, you need to live this. That's why I think people love me because, you know, who's your daddy, right? I will say the hard thing to you. I will tell you the hard things, and I'll tell people the hard things, and they'll go, I don't feel good about that. Well, bummer. Because I didn't write it. I'm just enforcing the truth. And if you don't like it, then who's your fight with? God. You. Right? That's how people leave. They get mad at me. But guess what? If I can't show you what the issue is through the word, then run from me. But if I show you in the word and you go, well, I love this one. I don't agree with that. Or that's your interpretation. What interpretation else do you have? Well, I just don't like it. Who's your fight with? God. But sadly, you take it, not you guys, but the first service takes it out of me. No, kidding. There used to be a first service, but now I just play. I don't know who it is. John 10:11 says this. Jesus said this. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. Verse 12. But a hireling or someone who just does it for the money. He who is not a shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf, or Satan, you could say, coming, and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them. Verse 13, the hireling flees because he is a hireling, hear this, and does not care about the sheep. We need pastors, we need leaders that care deeply about the sheep, amen? And Jesus, because we all want to be Christ-like, and here's what Jesus said, verse 14, I am the good shepherd, and I know my sheep. This is why we're starting the discipleship groups, so there'll be more hands on deck. There'll be more good shepherds around here, because how many know, as I've told, I think I said this Wednesday night, but I get in trouble. I seem to, I can't win for losing a lot of times. I'll be out in the lobby talking to you guys, you know, and, you know, how do you know? There's a lot of pastors, they don't even talk to sheep anymore, right? I was saying how there's some Calvary guys that bum me out. They just come out like a door like this to teach, and then as soon as they're done teaching, they leave, and you don't see them at all. I love what Pastor Chuck Smith said before he went to the Lord. He said, if your ministry is greater than that of one-on-one ministry, then your ministry is greater than that of Jesus. I mean, there's a lot of pastors that their ministry is greater than that of Jesus, at least in their mind. But here's where I get in trouble. I'll be talking to you, and someone will be engaging me. Very interesting conversation, and I'll just be talking away and talking, and all of a sudden there's a little few people waiting, and then I'll see people and just stomp off. But then, so then I say, okay, I can't talk to one person too long. So then I try to go talk to the one person, then go, hey, how you doing, Ted? And then the people that I'm talking to get mad because he doesn't care. He doesn't care. I was pouring out my heart, and he just went, hey, Ted, I can't believe it. I'm out of here. So you get my point? I can't win for losing, right? I talk too much to one person. I don't talk enough. I talk to everyone. He's big, but there's still not enough to go around. So what's the point? We need more people, right? You need to be friends with more people. We need to entrust this to faithful men and faithful women that can be many me's, okay, many Craigs, right? That can be shepherds. So you have people that have the same heart like Timothy had with Paul that can pour out to the people, amen? That are under authority, right, of God, and they're under the authority of me, and then, right, we're all saying the same thing in a sense. We're not preaching two different gospels, but we're all saying the same thing. That's the prayer for the discipleship group. And hear this, I need to say this, these groups aren't just a Bible study. This isn't just another Bible. This is where the leaders care about you. They pour into you. They pray for you. If you have trouble, I would hope the first person you would call would be your leader because, or the people in your group, because you have that closeness to them. Amen? And not be frustrated. As I told you, one person left because they called me on a Saturday night and they said, they made a fleece. They said, if Craig doesn't call me back in 2 hours, I am going to leave the church. And my son just blew out his ACL, and so I couldn't call them. How many know? But if you had a little home group leader, they could possibly call you. Amen? But if everything comes to me, it's going to fail. Amen? Verse 21. For all seek their own, or their own interests, none of the things which are of Christ Jesus. Verse 22, but you know his proven character of Timothy, that as a son with his father, he serves with me in the gospel. Verse 23, therefore I hope to send him at once as soon as I see how it goes with me. Paul's hoping he's going to be freed from Rome. He's not sure what's going to happen. Timothy was one who didn't have his own personal agenda or his own selfish ambition. If you remember in James 3:14, it says selfish ambition is what? Earthly, sensual, what? Demonic. You have selfish ambition, self-rule in your life. Guess what you open yourself up to? The demonic. If Jesus prayed, here's my request, Father, let this cup pass. But how did he end the prayer? Not my will, but your will be done. If you want to be safe, every prayer you pray should have, here's my request, but what? Not my will, but your will be done. You do that, and you will be demonic free most of your life. Amen? Timothy cared about the people that his father, hear this, in the faith cared about. Why did Paul care? Because he cared because Jesus gave him that command to care. Jesus gave him that ministry. But now Timothy, who's the protege of Paul, is now saying, because my father in the faith, Paul, cares so much about you Philippians, I now care so much about you. How many know that's, see the chain of command, see how it works? And he says, now I care. And he chose to serve with Paul this as his son, hear this, I love this, serves with his father in his family business. I pray that my children, I don't want to force them into ministry, but I pray that they see the family business of ministry and they say, hey, you know what, I've seen it. It's not easy, but it's the most fulfilling thing in the world. I love what I think was Spurgeon said, don't stoop from being a pastor to be a king. And I pray that my kids, you know, want ministry. I pray that they want ministry. And if they choose something else, I pray that they'll be a minister in whatever they do. But I pray they will follow the family business because hopefully they love their father and have seen the power of God in the ministry. Amen. Thank you, Ken. There you go. And thank you, my. There you go. He was willing, Timothy was willing to go where Paul wanted him to go. When no one else would go, he was saying, I'll go, Paul. I'll go see how the Philippians, you're in jail, I'll go see. Paul's desire was to send his son the faith to see how the Philippian church was doing in the Lord. I love this. I heard this story the other day. It said, Henry III, a great Bavarian king in Germany, first came into power and he was burdened by the responsibilities and demands of being king. Feeling the pressure on all sides, he finally walked away from the throne and went to a monastery. How many? That doesn't happen too much anymore, right? We want term limits. This guy's saying, I want out. I can't take this. I want to just be a monk. So he went to a monastery, and here's what he said. He said to the monk, I want to contemplate God and worship the Lord with all my heart. I understand this. The monk said, I understand this, Henry. Well, the first requirement of a monk is that he be in total submission. A monk's life is not his own. Can you submit yourself to the Lord by trusting in my counsel? Yes, said Henry. Then go back to the throne. I'm instructing you to rule and to serve where God Almighty has planted you. Henry indeed did return to the throne, becoming one of the greatest German kings of all history. The inscription on his tombstone explains it. It says, Henry III, the king who learned to rule by being obedient. I like that, amen? I like how, as I said earlier, how George Washington said, and think about our leaders today, he said, you cannot be a good governor of people if you yourself are not governed by God. How many know, Christian, you know, people are saying, should we put Romney in the White House? And I love someone said that's the lesser of two evils. And I love what one man of God said. He says, hey, as long as Jesus isn't on the ballot, you're always voting for the lesser of two evils. Get it? Okay, now we want Christians in there, but how many know we also have to sometimes take what we get, right? And we need to get people in government that hold to our biblical values, amen, that don't say, oh, I'm a Christian, and then live like the devil or and endorse abortion or radical homosexual sexuality. We need to say, no, we cannot support that. I just want to say this as a pastor, oh, how we need more Timothys in the church, amen. More Timothys that say, you know, I am a man under authority. I will do what my leaders say. I will, unless it's unbiblical, I will care about what my pastor cares about or those my youth pastor cares about or people or my dad cares about because I trust them to do the things of God. And if they don't, I'll show them. But if they tell me something that's godly, I'm going to trust. And I'm going to say, you really want me to go to Philippi? I'll go if that's the heart of God. I'll go. I'll trust you. Well, some of you might be saying, that's great for you, Pastor Craig, that, you know, maybe you want me to be a Timothy or a Timothina if you're a girl. But what do I get out of it? You know, sometimes it was like I was trying to wrestle with this kid this week of submitting to God, and I kind of had to, you know, I felt like Joel Osteen. I had to kind of say, well, if you do this, this is what God's going to give you. You sow your seed faith gift, and here's what you get. Okay, I don't want to do that, but I do want to tell you the benefit of surrendering to God. I do want to tell you that because guess what? Has anyone ever asked, what do I get out of giving my whole life to God? What do I get out of not partying and living for self? And what do I get out of tithing, giving money to? I had one guy say, I could have bought a Harley by now. Does anyone ever ask that question? Okay, yeah, there we go. One guy. The rest of you are liars. Okay. Lord bless them. You know, help them not to lie. All right, here it is. Luke 18:18. And I'm going to read the whole story. It's about the rich young ruler, but I want you to hear it so you get the context here. It says, once a religious leader asked Jesus this question, good teacher, what should I do to inherit eternal life? Verse 19, why do you call me good? Jesus asks, only God is truly good. Verse 20, but to answer your question, you know the commandments. Do you obey the commandments? You must not commit adultery. You must not murder. You must not steal. You must not testify falsely. Honor your father and mother. And here this young man, the rich young ruler, said, the man replied, I have obeyed all these commandments since I was young. Now hear that. Just because you even obey commandments doesn't mean you're saved. What? Because guess what? You'll hear in a second, if there's an area of your life that you're not surrendering, that should scare us. Here it is, right here, verse 22. When Jesus heard his answer, he looked at him and he said, there is still one thing you haven't done. You hear that? Just one thing. Sell your possessions and give the money to the poor, and you have treasure in heaven. Hear that? Do you hear that? He's saying, here's your problem. You're disobeying the first commandment of the Ten Commandments. You're disobeying, have no other gods before me. Your God is your what? Money. Thank God none of us have that problem, right? None of us love money. No one, right? How can you speak so bad about it, right? Right? So his money, now hear this. If you're rich, you don't have to get all your money and you know, if you want to give it to the church, that's okay. But you don't have to give it all to the poor, give it away. You don't have to. But when it's your God, when you live for money, then Jesus says, get rid of it because it's going to cost you your soul. And what does the Bible say? What does it mean to gain the whole world? Have billions of dollars and lose your soul in the strife. Amen? That was a weak amen, but I'll take it. He says, then come follow me. He could have been the 13th disciple. Do you realize this? If this man died and did not accept Jesus, how much is that money worth? 70, 80 years of pleasure? To spend eternity apart from God in total poverty of spirit and soul? Torment? Do you think that guy would beat his chest, gnashing of teeth, weeping, and saying, oh, I can't believe I traded my temporal wealth for walking with Jesus. Verse 23, but when the man heard this, he became very sad. Just like when I show people the word and they don't want to obey it. Very sad, for he was very rich. And I love Jesus. You don't hear Jesus beg him to come. You don't hear him go, come on. Okay, just sow 5% and I'll let it all go. Right? He says, okay, go. Verse 24, when Jesus saw this, he said, he talks now to his disciples, how hard it is for a rich to enter the kingdom of God. And guess what? Rich doesn't just mean money. Rich can be pride. Rich can be self. Rich can be pleasure. He says how hard it is for the rich, to enter the kingdom of God. Verse 25, in fact, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God. Verse 26, those who heard this said, then who in the world can be saved? He replied, verse 27, this is impossible for man. What is impossible for man is possible with God. Verse 28, Peter said, and I love this. Here's us, if you're honest. Ryan, this is you. Here it is. He said, yes, or Peter said, see, we have left all to follow you. So you see, Peter's kind of saying, man, how come he gets to walk away? I didn't get to walk away. I left my business. I left money. Why did he get to walk away? Amen? Do you agree? He's kind of going, I can't believe, make him come back. We could be riding in a chariot, Jesus. Do you understand how good this could be? If he just gave 10%, he said, let him go. And Jesus and Paul and Peter is kind of going, man, how come I didn't get to, you know, remember that? When Jesus said, do you want to leave us? He goes, where else can we go? I thought about it, but I'm ruined. You're the only one with the words of eternal life. I can't. Where can I go? I'm going to always be haunted. Oh, I'm running from God. Aren't you glad you can't run from God? I've sure tried hard, right? But what does it say? Someone tell me this. Hear this. If you're kind of bummed that you get disciplined, that you can't run, you're kind of like Peter, hear this. Hebrews 12, where he says, the Lord disciplines those he loves. Any son who's not disciplined is illegitimate. So if you're out there, you know, being rearing up, doing whatever you want, then maybe the Lord isn't your Lord. But if you kind of run off and all of a sudden you get a little swat in your, hey! No, it's because God loves you. because you have surrendered your life to him. And hear this, not because he doesn't love the other people, but because, why? This man's heard what God asked, and he said, no, Lord. Do you get the difference? And you and I, hopefully most of us in this room, have said, wow, that's intense, Lord, giving up everything for you. But yes, Lord, you're worth it. Verse 29, yes, Jesus replied, and I assure you, so here's what he's saying to Peter. Here's for you guys, for us. He says, yes, Jesus replied, I assure you that everyone who's given up stuff for me, I can't believe you did it. No, here's what he says. I assure you that everyone who's given up houses and or wife, now hear this, that doesn't mean you have to give up your house, but meaning my house, you see my house? This house is better than my house because I spend more time, a lot of times, on this house than I do my own house. But how many know, I'd rather care more about God's house than my own house? Because remember what David said? I live in a palace while the house of God is in ruins. How many know, some of you treat your own house way, 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 way better than the house of God, and God says, and I'm kind of concerned how you treat my house. You want a new TV? Boom, we get a new TV. How many know, we would like some things in the house. People say, hey, we need more fellowship. Well, guess what? We're under budget. How can we build a fellowship hall and the overhang there? We've gotten bids for it. You know everything's cheap to build nowadays? You know that? It's real cheap, right? $37,000 is the best bid we've gotten. How many know if we're under $6,000, we can't build stuff to have fellowship to be able to hang out? Now, I don't mean to guilt you, but I'm just telling you a hard reality. But I want to tell you this. Hear this. Can I just say this is free? I'm going to make you, since you already gave me that look, I might as well just go for it, right? Do you realize they said if everyone tithed 10%, the average church brings in, I think the church in America brings in about $3 to $4 billion a year. But they said if every Christian tithed, the church would bring in $73 billion. Do you know how much the church could do? Now, some churches would do wrong, but do you know what we could do? It'd be so nice in an elder meeting to just go, we have so much money, what do we do with it? We don't have that problem. But wouldn't it be neat? Like, what do we do? Everything, all the bills are paid, the church is paid for, we got to find missions, we got to find people to give to. Wouldn't that be neat? No, not really. I think it would be neat. Amen. Thank you, Alicia. But he says, anyone who's given up, everyone who gives up houses, meaning living for your house, or wives, meaning you don't live just for your wife. Remember he said, Paul said, if you're married, then live as one single, meaning be radical. Doesn't mean you don't love your wife, but don't just live for your wife, but live for God. Brothers, parents, don't. If your parents, what if you're a Muslim and your parents say, hey, you can't accept Jesus, I'm a Muslim, you're going to have to kill you. You have to renounce parents. And he says, children, I love this. I'll say this real quick. I never forget, I asked this guy to be an elder once, and he said, well, I can't be an elder. And I said, why can't you be an elder? He says, because I want to. I made a vow to God to tuck my child in every single night of her life. I said, well, you can't just want maybe just pray. Like, I'll sometimes will come in late and I'll just pray for my daughter. I'll put my hands on her head. But I said, you can't one night a week, you can't come to Wednesday night service and miss that. And he said, nope. And I just thought of the verse where God says, I honor those who honor me. And people will say to me, by the grace and strength of God, they will say to me, Craig, your kids aren't like normal pastor's kids. And I say it's because of my phenomenal parenting. No, kidding, just kidding. I say it's because I've put God first by the grace and strength of God, and God has honored me because I've honored him, and he's taken care of my kids when I haven't always been there like I would like to always tuck them in or read them a book or do everything. But guess what? When I'm there, I'm there, and I think God makes up for it. You put your kids first, you'll lose them. You put God first, God will fill in the gaps for what you do. Does that make sense? And I'm not saying be a workaholic away. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying, does that make sense? Put God first. And what? Seek first the kingdom. All these things shall be added. Your kids will be in right balance. Amen? Two of you agreed. All right, that's cool. All right, here it is. He says, children, for the sake of the kingdom of God, hear this, verse 30. Here's for you. This is a Joel Osteen moment. will be repaid many times over in this life and will have eternal life in the world to come. You want abundant life in your Christianity? You want peace in your home? You want deliverance? Then give up whatever God is asking you to give up. Surrender to God and you will never lose. Submit to God and you will have reward in this life and the life to come. And when I do, I'm getting old now, maybe you'll do my funeral, but if I do your funeral, I'll be able to see your eyes, have that glistening eyes, those smiling eyes of going, I'm ready to meet the Lord, not, right? You'll be like, oh. I love the story about D.L. Moody. When he died, it says he all of a sudden, he kind of died, and they thought he died, and then he woke up again, and everyone, and he goes, it's glorious, it's glorious. I've seen our grandchildren. His two grandchildren died of like polio or something. And he goes, it's glorious, it's glorious. I see them, it's awesome. If this is death, I welcome it, I love it. And then he died. Wouldn't that be cool? Instead of, you know, more morphine, I can't take it. No, wouldn't it be neat if you could just smile into, you know what I mean? You could just, like, remember, I don't know if you ever saw Gladiator? When death looks at you, all you can do is he smiles at you, all you can do is smile back, right? Shouldn't we be able to do that? Oh, death, where's your sting? I'm ready to go. I'm excited, right? Death's like, you know? Now, here's where some of us get stuck, and I'm going to read this, and I'm already going late, so just deal with it. Here it is. There's plenty of church. He'll give you a short sermon if you want it. Here it is, Psalm 73, verse 3. You don't have to turn, just write it down if you want. But he says, Asaph is saying this, I was envious of the boastful when I saw the prosperity of the wicked. Ever been jealous of the wicked? I've never been jealous of the world that much anymore, but I get jealous of worldly Christians sometimes. Anyone else get jealous? I get jealous of the Christians that go on vacation every other weekend to Telluride. I can't even go on Telluride once a year. They go every other week. I get jealous sometimes. Now skip with me to verse 12. He says, look at these wicked people enjoying a life of ease while their riches multiply. Verse 13, did I keep myself pure for nothing? Did I keep myself innocent for no reason? Skip to verse 17. He says, then I went into your sanctuary. Or you could say for us today, I went to church or I prayed or I read. He says, I went to your sanctuary, O God, and I finally understood the destiny of the wicked or those who live for self. Verse 18, truly you put them on a slippery path. You send them sliding over the cliff to destruction. Verse 19, in an instant, they are destroyed, completely swept away by terrors. I want to tell you, there's a lot of people that when they die, even in the name of Jesus, that are terrified of facing God because they realize they lived their life for what? Self. Me. I did it my way. But I pray for you, church, that you will be submitted to God. You'll yield to him so that when you die or when you're raptured, you're excited about seeing God because you sacrificed and you yielded everything that God asked you to yield. Amen? Let's submit to God and his will for our lives so that we can have the confidence that we will be rewarded in this life and his spiritual blessings in our family and the life to come so that we can have peace. You know what they say? Why counselors exist? The main thing they're trying to deal with is guilt, shame, regret. You live for God with all your heart. You might not be able to go on vacation every other weekend, but guess what? You will not have guilt. You will not have shame. And you will not have fear of death. And I pray that for all of us today. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much. Help us, Lord, to be in this world, but not of this world. Help us, Lord, to not be envious of Christians or so-called Christians that are living carnal lives. But let us be like Timothy, who care about what you care about and care about what their spiritual father cares about. And says, Lord, I'll do whatever you want. If you want me to go to Philippi, though no one else wants to go, I'll go. If you want me to give this thing up, I'll give it up. If you want me to do something I'm not doing, I'll do it. Because, Lord, I don't want any regret. I don't want to look back at my life when I'm an old man or an old woman and say, oh my, I spent most of my years in Jesus living for myself. I know, Father, that in a way this is a hard teaching. But it's just hard because many pastors aren't preaching it in America. But I pray that your Holy Spirit would seal it in your people's hearts that this is not an unbiblical teaching. That this is a true teaching. As your word says in James 4:7, submit therefore to God. Come under the authority of God. Submit therefore to God and resist the devil. And he not maybe will flee or might flee. He must flee. And you said, draw near to you, and you will draw near to us. So, Father, right now, if people have been convicted by you of areas that aren't right, areas that aren't yielded, I ask that they would confess them. But they wouldn't just leave it there. They would say, Lord, now help me to obey you. Help me to let go of something, or help me to take on something of prayer or obedience or holiness. But, Lord, I want to end this day and the rest of the days of my life on this earth without any guilt, without any shame, without any regret, without any fear of death. That if I was to die at midnight tonight, I could die well because every area I was aware of was yielded to God. Bless your people. May this not be just a cute sermon. May this not just be a cute teaching, but may this be a way of life for us. Submitted to you, that we would say, I want to govern my family well. I want to govern wherever you give me authority. But the only way I can do that is by being under your authority. Bless your people with that submitted mind that you exemplified for us, Lord Jesus. We love you, and I bless your people right now in the most powerful name, the name above all names, the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Bless them. In obedience to submitting their lives to you. Amen.